Okay, we're continuing our series on study. Correct. Okay, it's a wedding portion. Responses and how God has been working with this one particular man, Moses, and through Moses, many more people. Okay, but it is so amazing because this morning, I'm telling you, I did not have a conversation with Divakar, and so much of the songs were to do with the name of Jesus. And this morning, in this particular portion, I mean, I don't know, maybe Divakar was also seeing Exodus 3, because he knows what we're doing. We're going to be looking at that name of God, really. Okay, we're going to be looking at the name Yahweh God, and then we're going to sing why and how does that... It's even evident in the New Testament. And then we're going to see the name of Jesus. How is it very special for us? All right? But what's in a name? What's in a name? In Hindi, you have these... I was only looking at the, you know, Google and memes that you have a tagline, Naam mein kya rakha hai? And then there are many dialogues like, you know, Naam mein kya rakha hai? Yeah, I'll throw at it. My good friend Achinta. It's just a beautiful name, Achinta. Naam mein kya rakha hai? Aajkal kabhi kabhi Achinta bhi chinta kar leta hai. Okay, and so that is just. But do you all know the meaning of your names? You know the meaning of your name? Everyone knows that. Most likely, all of us know the meaning. Do you all think you live up to the meaning of your name? Okay, you live up to the meaning of your name, of course. Yeah, very nice. Huh? Ruth is a peacemaker. I know it because she has invited me to her home. You know, they've invited us to her home, and she makes very good pieces. Ruth is also a good friend, so you can joke. Okay, this is all recorded, no? Okay, but I just want to say, let's just come back. I just want to say that in these Old Testament biblical times, you know, when names were given to people, it actually implied something. And therefore, there were times and moments where even names were changed, you know. We're not going to go into the details of all of that, but we're going to be seeing... why what's in a name is not necessarily true of the Bible, because the name reveals a lot. Okay, biblically. Can I invite somebody to come and read for us the Bible reading for today? Exodus 3 verses 11 to 22. Is there somebody willing to come up and just read it? Shalu, why don't you come?
But Moses said to God, "Who am I that should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" And God said, "I'll be with you, and this will be the sign of you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, who will worship God on his mountain." Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers have sent me to you,' and they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites: I am has sent me to you." God also said to Moses, "Say to the Israelites, 'The Lord, the God of your fathers, the Lord of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob's, send me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from the generation to generation. Go assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, 'The Lord, the God of your fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, the Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt. And I have promised to bring you up out of your misery in Egypt into the land of Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. Land flowing with milk and honey. The elders of Israel will listen to you. Then you, the elders, are to go to the king of Egypt and say to him, "The Lord, God of the Hebrews, have met with us. Let us take a 3-day journey into the wilderness to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I'll stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I'll perform among them. After that, he'll let you go. And I'll make the Egyptians favorably disposed towards his people, so that when you leave, you will not go empty-handed. Every woman is to ask her neighbor and any woman living in her house for articles of silver and gold and for clothing, which you will put on your sons and daughters, and so you will plunder the Egyptians."
Let's pray as we start. Heavenly Father, even as we are committing this time to just being enriched by your word, to just feast on your word, I pray that you would, Holy Spirit, would you be speaking to each of our hearts? Would we be seeing things about this familiar passage with freshness? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Yeah. So I started off saying that names carry very significant meaning. You think of a name like Abraham, okay? It means the father of the multitude. You think of a name like Jacob. Jacob means an imposter, a rivaler, a challenger, okay? Now, there are many names, but Abraham lived true to his name. His name aligned with what God's plan was, to become the father of the nations. Jacob lived to what his name was. He actually rivaled his brother Esau and obtained his father's blessings. Now, in this story, in the story of Moses, Moses is now called. God is calling Moses. Moses is called to serve as a mediator. And Moses is asking, "God, what's your name?" He's just received a daunting task. It's a very Herculean task. It's a very difficult job that God has asked him to do. And the first thing he's asking, "God, if I go back to my people, they're going to ask, who are you? Who has sent you?" He wants to know, what is his name? That's exactly what he asks, isn't it? And the whole 12 verses is what God's response is. And in God's response in these 12 verses, is God doesn't just, you know, give closed-ended answers and responses to Moses. There's a lot of depth in what God is revealing to Moses, who he is and who he was and who and what he will do. It's a constant revelation that he's allowing Moses to know about him. Okay, as Shalu just read for us. One of the most striking aspects, actually, if you see and you start this, is the fact that God actually revealed his name to Moses. You know, to a man like Moses. Who was Moses by now? While Moses did grow up in royalty, he could have gone on to become the prince, but he was a failed prince. Isn't it? He was a failed prince. He became a murderer. He was on the run. He was a fugitive. Now he's doing shepherding job. To that kind of a man with a horrible track record, with a not a good past performance, to that person, God actually revealed so much. Isn't that interesting? Okay. So Moses realizes this task that God has given him is great. Moses also realizes in his response that the Israelites are not likely to believe that God has sent him. You realize that? I mean, keep your Bibles open. You'll realize he's realizing that there's a possibility that his own people, after all these years, when he goes back, will not believe him. So Moses responds with two strong emotions in that verse, and I'm reading verse 13. Moses responds with two strong emotions. Emotion number one is there's a sense of anxiety. What if I go back? They're going to ask me all these questions. I'm worried, God. But there's another emotion. It's boldness. In fact, the English word is audacity. He's actually got the guts to ask God, God, tell me more about you. Reveal more about you. Yes, I'm a murderer. Yes, I'm a fugitive. Yes, I'm on the run. Yes, I'm a... But tell me more. I want to know. So there are these... Can you see it in that verse? Can you see it in verse 13? Okay, let me just read the verse. It says, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your father has sent me, they'll ask me, what is his name? What should I tell them? What should I say to them? Can you see anxiety and audacity together? You know, this. If it was today's conversation, I'd be, just do it. No, but he's got the audacity. God, tell me more. Reveal a little more about yourself. And so Moses' actions are quite understandable. Even if it's audacious, it's quite understandable. But the striking thing is, in an act of intimacy in verses 14, God actually stoops down. God actually comes down to Moses' level and gives Moses what he's asking for. Okay? And the next 12 verses on this chapter explains of this revelation of God that Moses gets. Now, it's a revelation of God's name and the name of God. God is explaining to Moses why his name resonates with his character. Okay, and we're going to be studying that. But this, friends, what we see in these 12 verses goes on to become the fuel, goes on to become the, you know, resource that Moses needs to actually stand up to these big men, you know, Pharaoh and all the magicians and all these. This becomes, this 12 verses that you know, this interaction and what God is revealing to Moses becomes the fuel for him to go and stand up to all these people in Egypt, okay? So the encounter between God and Moses demonstrates that God chooses to reveal himself. God does not choose to leave Moses in the dark. Moses has questions. He's in a place of anxiety. He has all these different questions and doubts. And God chooses not to leave Moses there. God chooses to reveal himself, show him what Moses wants. The fact that he revealed his names to Moses is remarkable. It's a revelation of himself. Ultimately, now that we are living so many years after the pre-redemption and then the redemption, and now we are living so many years after that, we see in the Word of God, God in fact shares his name and allows all his children, like you and me, to identify with his name. Ultimately, we will read in the New Testament, it says that in Philippians, no other name is given higher than any other than the name of Jesus. And we're going to be seeing how that is consistent theologically with Scripture. But before that, think about this. Moses in a place of doubt. Moses in a place of questions. Moses is in a place of not having a good track record. He's not even worthy to be one of God's, general to be in this freedom fighting movement. And he's asking God all these questions. What does it teach you and me? What does it teach us about God's willingness to meet us in our moments of doubt and uncertainty? What does it tell us about God? What does it teach us? The fact that God is willing to not leave you and me in the dark. To not leave you and me in the dark. It challenges our perception of who God is, isn't it? God is, high and above. God is supreme. He is sovereign. He is seated high on the throne. And yet, he's not just far and away. This King of Kings and Lord of Lords, seated on the throne, it is true, he is supreme being. And yet, he is not far and away. He is close and he's willing to come down and meet us where we are. Yeah. This is one thing that I just want to, it's just a thought I think we should consider. Okay, so verse 14, the name that God gives to Moses is this name, I am who I am. Devakar spoke about a little bit during the worship. It's the in the Hebrew it's Yahweh, and that's the Hebrew alphabets. Now, if you are reading your Bible, maybe on a YouVersion app or maybe in a study Bible, where you see in verse 14, God said to Moses, "I am who I am." Is there a dialogue box or a footnote? Yeah? What does that footnote say? What does the footnote say? Or I will be what I will be. Okay? Why is that there? Just to say that this English language, you know, I mean, when a Hebrew Jewish person reads these four letters, they understand the meaning. English, we'll have to skip 2-3 sentences to actually get the whole meaning. Now, what this really means is, this is translated also Yahweh is the name in its reality. In an adapted version, many decades later on, they began to use the word Jehovah. Okay, it's an adapted name of the word Yahweh. But apart from all of that, it's a name that actually translates to the verb to be. To be. Okay, in Hindi it is like hona. You know, whether it is metha, mehu, mehame, you know, mehona, you know. And so the word to be is this word is translated to that. So what this in what this in effect means, we don't need to study Hebrew, but what this in effect means is that this name Yahweh, this name I am, that who I am, I will be who I will be, is a name that conveys an active, continuous, self-existent presence of God. What it means is, it wasn't that the presence of God existed at one time and stops existing at another time. That's not what the name Yahweh means. That's not what the name of God means. The name of God means a continuous self-existent. He is not dependent on anything to be existent. He just exists. That's the name, that's the meaning of his name. He is. He was and he will be and it never changes. Okay? Now keep that in the back of your mind, that the meaning of who this I am who I am or I will be who I will be, in effect means that he continues to exist. That's just what it means. Okay? As you go down, so he is the God who has no beginning, he has no end, he is self-sufficient, it's self-determined. He owes his existence to no one other than himself. He is the God who is. But now there is more. There is more. He is a self-existent God, but there is more to this. Look at 14. Now we're looking at, I'm just reading 14 and I'll go to 15. God said to Moses, I am who I am. Or footnote, I will be who I will be. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am Yahweh, that is, a self-existent, continues to, I will never cease to exist. That God, I am, has sent me to you. God has also said to Moses, say to the people of Israel, the Lord, which is also the same. See the footnote, Yahweh. Can you see the L-O-R-D in capital letter with a footnote in your Bible? If you click that footnote, it'll give you the name Yahweh, correct? Okay, that's okay. Oh, I changed my screen. One sec, guys. The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. And then he says again in 15, this is my name. So he just started off in verse 14 saying, I am is my name, I am is sending you. And now in 15 he is saying, "The God, say this to the people, the God of your fathers, the Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has said, this is my name forever." Oh, we're getting a second variety. We're getting a second impression of what God wants to convey to Moses. He's revealing a little bit more now. What is he saying? The revelation of who I am in verse 14 spoke of the fact that God is existent, but this additional revelation reveals that this God relates to people and relates in a way covenantly. And we're going to see why that makes sense. He is not only the God who is, but he's also the God who is with his people. All right? So in 15 it says, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and Isaac. God, now why Abraham, Isaac and Jacob? For many of us who are Christians, we would have heard this term before. For many of us who are still coming to the church for the first time and exploring what's so interesting about these names, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, God in history, God had entered into a covenant with Abraham. All right? And we know about it. It starts with Genesis 12, 13, 14, and chapter 15. He makes all of this. Don't go there, but it's there in Genesis 12 to 15. Now, God had entered into a covenant with Abraham. This covenant was not just for Abraham's life. It, in fact, extended for the generations after Abraham as well. We agree? We realize that? So God was reminding Moses, and actually by implication, God was reminding the entire nation of Israel that he is intimately involved with them. If you see the later verses, he says, I have not forgotten the struggles you all are in. I have not forgotten my promise. And by connecting himself directly with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God is demonstrating to Moses that he is an intimate and personal God. Friends, I don't know if you're aware, but God seems to be making sure that Moses needs to know, Moses, you're not going to be alone. God seems to be making sure that Moses knows that he would not be alone. Yeah. Think about that for us today. In the book of Hebrews, it says in Hebrews 13:5, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. The promise of God's presence is not limited to Moses alone. It's in fact shared by each of us because of what Christ did on the cross, to each of us who are under that same covenantal care of God. In fact, in the New Testament, and this was in the New Covenantal era, the church, the early church that sprung out from the book of Acts and then went everywhere, they also continued to experience the presence of Jesus when Jesus promised in Matthew 28, you know, therefore go and make disciples, baptize them, all of that. And then verse 20, and I will be with you till the end of the age. And you know what's interesting? This is not just what we're seeing in Exodus. This is not just what we're seeing in Jesus saying it. Between these two periods, there was Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah. He prophesied to Israel in chapter 7, verse 14. And he was saying things like, and this virgin will give birth to a son and he will redeem. And he will be called Emmanuel. What is the meaning of Emmanuel? God with us. So this cannot be a coincidence. This cannot be a random thing. No, it's a character of God seen in the Trinity, expressed in the life of God, the Father, the Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. How do we know today, how do you and I know today that you and I are not alone? Yeah? The Bible speaks of how the Holy Spirit in us reminds us that Christ dwells with us. All right? Anyway, I want to address three points today. What I want to address is there are these three things that we are learning of a revelation. You know what's a revelation, right? You get to know things. Moses has got to know things. It's revealed to him, okay? So the first thing the first learning is we're introduced to a God. He's introduced to a God who keeps his covenantal promise. In verses 16 and 17, God is giving further instructions to Moses on how to proceed. So he's asked God these questions, and now God is giving him more instructions how to proceed. What does it say in 16, 17? Go assemble the elders of Israel, say to them, the Lord, God of fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you, I've seen what has been done to you in Egypt, I've promised to bring you out of your misery, I'll bring you into a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, this is a conversation that God is telling Moses. But this was not a new conversation, my friends. How do we know that? what God was going to do in delivering the Israelites from this bondage, from the Egyptians, was not a new idea. This was grounded in history. It was grounded in a historical covenant. If you read Genesis 15, Abraham knew that this is going to happen. This is God speaking to Abraham in Genesis chapter 15, 12 and 13. As the sun was setting, that time his name was Abraham, it was his old name, fell into a deep sleep, a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, now this him is not Moses, this is Abraham. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and they will be mistreated there. And then the next verse, in verse 14, it says, but I will punish the nation that they serve as slaves. Afterward, they will come out with great possessions. This was a covenant told to Abraham several years ago. His grandchild, that is Jacob, also knew about this. In Genesis chapter 46, God spoke to Israel. That time Jacob's name was Israel. Jacob, Jacob, here I am, he replied. I am God, the God of your father. Don't be afraid to go to Egypt. I will make you a great nation there. I will go down to Egypt with you, and I will surely bring you back. So this was this thing of, you know, this freedom movement of being freed from slavery and coming back into the country that God was using Moses was not a new idea. God had already reminded Abraham and Jacob. God had promised to bring his people back. Moses was the human leader that God, you know, worked and partnered with to fulfill this promise. The name that God gave to Moses is this, is his covenant name. It is rooted in a historical covenant. It's a name that reminds us that God acts in history and will keep his covenant. Moses now had the assurance and comfort of knowing that this promise-keeping God was going with him. While Moses had the knowledge that God was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph, he also now realizes he's the God of Moses as well. He's making a promise to Moses, isn't it? He's telling Moses the action plan. God was not only the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but also the God of Moses. And so the comfort that Moses had is a comfort that each of us can have. Okay? Think about our lives today. I'm pretty sure all of us seated here, not most of us, not some of us, I'm pretty sure all of us seated here have experienced what broken promises look like. Yeah, broken promises is such a painful aspect of our existence. If you've ever had a friend, if you've ever had a business partner, your boss, your spouse, your employer, your parents, if you've ever had one or all of these relationships break a promise with you, you very well understand the grief that is associated with a broken promise. Yeah. I think of my wedding day sometimes. I think of, you know, in the presence of my pastor, you know, there were witnesses, there were the leaders, all my friends were there. I said so many things in my vow to Esther. You know, I will always be there for you. And I don't think I didn't mean it. My intention was to mean it. You know, I will always love you. You know, we will always do things together. And I mean, I don't know what the exact words were, but that's essentially what it was. You know, I will love you, I will serve you, we'll do life together, and then there are days where, you know, we have a meltdown in our home. Oftentimes I'm the cause of the conflict. And I think how many times I have just broken or promise that I have told my own wife in front of, you know, 100 and many witnesses. Your parents, your friends, you know, people in church, your employer, your business partner. Broken promise is such a painful aspect. Like whatever you do, you just wish there was a course that you could do. 5 steps to live in a world where promises are kept. 7 things to do where people will not, you know, to be in a relationship where promises are not broken. You long for something like that on Udemy or something. You don't get it. You know? And therefore, friends, every painful aspect of our existence with broken promises is a window. It's a window to celebrate the joy that we have as believers in serving a God who does not break promises. You know, we can be explorers and examiners and even Christians of our faith. We can either love Jesus or hate Jesus. We can be angry with Jesus. We can be upset because he doesn't give us what he wants. We can do all of that. What we cannot deny is that from the Word of God, he has never broken a promise. Yeah. And to ensure how far God will go to fulfill his promise, to ensure how far God will go, we see the victory of Jesus on the cross as evidence. He went as far as to send his son to die on the cross for us. Friends, in this conversation that God is having with Moses, God is revealing to Moses, you're not just on a random task. A promise-keeping God is with you. You're on a project that is a part of a covenantal history. Moses is now a different man when he is in touch with this God. The second aspect is, while God is a God who is a promise-keeping God, Moses is also introduced to the fact that this promise-keeping God is not a weak God. This promise-keeping God is not a frail, handicapped God. He's a powerful God. When I was growing up, when I finished my 10th standard, a very dear uncle who was like a father to me promised that he will give me something if I get, you know, a particular score in my 10th standard. You know, and I crossed what he thought, if you get at least 75%, I will give you this. And as a 16-year-old, that promise, what he told me was very, you know, I was really looking forward to it. He said he'll give me a bike. Okay. That's a different question, 16 and bike, but just stick to the details. Okay. And when I did cross 75, I actually got more than 75. I went and I reminded him, my results are out, uncle. This is what I got. And for various reasons, I didn't understand, you know, he couldn't get me what he promised. He said, okay, I'll take a loan. I don't have money. I don't know this. For me, that was not the question, right? I mean, why did you promise when you didn't? Like, he says, no, I didn't think you'll cross 75. Anyway, but the point is, as a 16-year-old, honestly, as a 16-year-old, I saw a promise-keeping uncle who was not powerful. We have, you know, we have our father figures or our mother figures who want to do so much, who promise to do, but there comes a time where they're not powerful enough to do it. And that's a funny dynamic, right? Like, you love the man because he's promised you so much. But he's not able to do it. He's limited. He's weak. He doesn't have resources with him. Moses is introduced to a promise-keeping God, but also to a God who's powerful. Anyway, let's just come back to scripture. So Moses knows that he's not going to be alone in this task. He can rely completely on God's faithfulness. God has revealed to him that he is all powerful. How do we know that? It's because the reason this revelation was so important to Moses was that he was about to take on the mighty Pharaoh, the magicians, and his army. So while having the revelation of God's covenant, it was even more comforting to know that God actually had the power to fulfill that promise. Okay? We're going to be seeing two verses, verses 18 and verses 20. Just keep your Bibles open. Over here, God is letting Moses know how powerful he is. He's demonstrating his power to Moses in two ways. So he's already let him know that he's a promise-keeping God, but now he's letting him know in two ways how powerful he is. So let's read verses 18. So verses 16 to 17 is where God is telling him to go. I've observed a promise, brought you out of the affliction. Yeah, so he's told Moses to go and talk to the elders. In verse 18 he says, and they will listen to you. They will listen to your voice. The elders of Israel shall go to the king of Egypt and say, the Lord God. In other words, God has demonstrated to Moses that he knows everything. He is so powerful because he knows what's going to happen. And he's just told Moses that he's assuring Moses that when I ask you to do all of these things, they will respond positively. So when somebody knows everything, okay, the English term is omniscient. Omni to say everything, scient to say knowledge. When somebody is omniscient, he comes across as somebody very powerful, right? You want to have that person in your team. Isn't it? Yeah, okay. I think I'm really excited. But verse 20, look at verse 20. So in verse 19 it says, but I know that the king of Egypt will not respond to you positively. In verse 19 it says, I know that the king of Egypt will not listen to your request. So look at verse 20, he says, I will stretch my own hand and strike Egypt with all the wonders that I will do. After that, he will let you go. God is declaring to Moses that he will perform wonders. He will display powers. You know, and the image you get is, and of course, ultimately what happened, but the image you get is this ferocious power of God, the language of God stretching out his arm, you know, the divine warrior in a battle. That's the image you get. That's what God can do. So the interesting thing is this, after reading verses 18 and verses 20, Moses is now convinced, I don't need an army. I don't need an army to oppose Pharaoh and his army, because God, with his power, will stretch his arm and that will be enough. So we're seeing a covenantal God, a promise-keeping God, but also saying how powerful he is. He knows everything. And when somebody is not responding to you, you don't worry, Moses. You don't get your army. I will be enough. God is not only omniscient, but he's also omnipotent. Potent is to say power. Okay, he's the great I am. God fulfills promises, but he also fulfills his promises with power. Unlike empty promises we see in our relationships. He's the God who can create all things out of nothing. Okay, the flood on the earth, the parting of the Red Sea, the toppling of the walls of Jericho. That's who he is, and that's how powerful he is. Okay, let me just go quickly. And let's just go to the third one. It's all of this pointing to Jesus. That's supposed to say learning number three. Okay, but I... And with this, I will begin to wrap up. I will begin to close. How does all of this point to Jesus? Can you just read? Is there Jesus anywhere in this passage? Is there Jesus, the name Jesus? Is there any mention of Jesus? It's not that Jesus is there. I'll tell you. Okay? It's not in this passage, but it's there. Now, God's name, the name that I am who I am, I will be who I will be, you know, the Yahweh name, Okay, reveals so much about who he is. It also reveals so much about the covenant he has with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It also reveals the fact that he is omniscient and omnipowerful, isn't it? We just saw all of that. Now, it's amazing to think of how much information is conveyed with those three letters, I am. Just two words, I am. Now, you come to the name of Jesus. Does anybody know the meaning of the name Jesus? Jesus? The meaning of the name Jesus? Yeah, Jesus is anointed. Yeah, correct. Okay, deliverer, savior, redeemer. The name of Jesus Christ actually means God saves. Okay, it means many things. Everything to do with God saving, through redeeming, through liberating, through... But ultimately, it means God saves. That's why in Matthew chapter 1, it says, she will give birth to a son and you are to give him the name Jesus because he will save people from their sins. Matthew 1:21. Okay. It also says, the name of Jesus is so powerful. It says in John chapter 14, and I will do whatever you ask me in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Okay. Additionally, we also see the name of Jesus is signifying supreme authority. In Philippians chapter 2, it says, therefore, God exalted him, meaning Jesus, to the highest place, gave him the name that is above every name. And so overall, the name of Jesus speaks of power, authority, divinity, all of that. Now, while all of that is true, there is something about the name of Jesus. There was a moment in history, that has a direct relationship to what we just read in Exodus chapter 3. There was a moment in history, and we're going to be looking at two verses in the book of John that reflects his divinity exactly the way we see it in Exodus chapter 3, verses 14, 15. In John chapter 8, and I'm going to go there, even y'all can go there. In John chapter 8, towards after 55, 56, okay, yeah, from 48 onwards, but I'm not going to be reading from 48, I'm going to be reading 56, 57. Jesus is having an exchange of conversation with a Pharisee. Pharisee were people who knew the law, you know, they were people who understood the law. They're very knowledgeable people, very respected people. They had seats in important places. And Jesus is having an exchange with the Pharisees, or conversation. And Jesus told them of Abraham seeing Jesus' day and rejoicing. Read verse 56. Your father, this is Jesus speaking to the Pharisees. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, you are not even 50 years old and you have seen Abraham? And over there there's a footnote, or which means, or has Abraham seen you? In verse 58 it says, truly, truly I tell you, before Abraham was. Now in that I am, which version are you reading? Can you see? It's not in small letters. It's the same I am in big letters with a footnote that points to the meaning Yahweh. Jesus has just told the Pharisees, just told the Jews who he is, the same way, the same name that God told Moses. That's the same name. It's not the same name that is common with many people. It's the same name. It's the same person. No, not interesting. No, it's not like there were like 10 people named Yahweh. With one name, Yahweh, one person, same person. Moses asks, what is his name? And God says, I am, meaning Yahweh. Jesus telling the Jews, before Abraham was, I am. The same person. He was saying what God was saying to Moses in Exodus chapter 3. Jesus, centuries later. Jesus is implying, and in effect is implying, that he's declaring that he is a self-existent. What did we learn about those three things? Self-existent, covenant-keeping, omnipotent, all-powerful, all-knowing God. And you know what's a strange thing that happened as soon as Jesus did this? The next verse, they picked up stones to throw at him. And these are not stones to throw at this. They wanted to kill him. Which means that what Jesus said was fiercely true. It challenged the theological understanding of these Jews. They thought it was outrageous. How on earth can anyone come and say that you are God? And he did it. No one dared use the name Yahweh simply. No one dared do it. And Jesus said it. And that's why we see the next verse. They wanted to kill him. And Jesus, of course, hid himself. He went out. Friends, like Moses and like the Israelites, outside of Jesus Christ, we are all subject to bondage. Our bondage is not to the Egyptians, but our bondage is to sin. It's to death, spiritually. And this Jesus for us, the great I Am, as we read in John 8, has delivered us from death. His name reminds us that he has the power to keep his covenant promise with us. His name reminds us that he has set us free. When it comes to Jesus, there's so much to a name. And when it comes to Jesus, you can never say, what's in a name? Naam mein kya rakha hai? No, when it comes to Jesus, there is so much in a name. Okay? As we begin to share communion, but I'd like us to just listen to a song. The song is about 4 minutes, but we'll only listen to two and a half minutes. It speaks about the name of Jesus. And it's a familiar song. It's on YouTube, but I'd love us to just, of course you can sing along, but I'd love for us to just reflect on everything that the song speaks about the name of Jesus, all right? You can play.
The name of Jesus is a refuge, a shelter from the storm, a help to those who call. The name of Jesus is a fortress, a saving place to run, a hope unshakable. When we fall, you are the Savior. When we call, you are the answer. There is power in your name. There is power in your name. In the name of Jesus, there is life and healing. Chains are broken.
For most of us who have not yet given our lives to Jesus, we can let the communion bread and juice pass. Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes, "Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by